and welcome to Chalk Talk. I'm Melody Bonnet. A symbolic swearing-in ceremony and reception was held to honor two new board members and 13 returning members of our newly elected school board. The board is anticipating a productive and successful year as they work together to make decisions regarding what's best for our students. Was held recently to honor the newly elected St. Tammany Parish School Board members. New and returning members participated in a symbolic swearing-in ceremony held at the beginning of the January meeting. Newly elected District 11 Representative Bob Womack is returning to the board after a 12-year hiatus.
Well, it feels wonderful considering that it's been 12 years that I've been off the board, and so it's kind of like a homecoming for me. I'm really thrilled and looking forward to giving my best.
Mr. Womack is looking forward to working with his fellow board members.
Everybody has the attitude of just working together. And so I think that we're all going to be very happy and do quite well together. I really do.
Jack Loop, newly elected board member for District 4, is a retired educator who brings a wealth of experience into his new role.
After being in this parish for 30 years and going through the whole gamut, teacher, coach, assistant principal, and principal, I do know a lot about the system. There's a lot, I guess, in the last 3 years that's come about that I haven't picked up on yet, but I'm certainly getting ready to learn some of that and just know that I can provide some input when the time comes and some familiarity with what goes on, and I hope that's very helpful to some of the other board members.
Donald Villery, returning board member for District 6, puts the main goal of the school board in perspective.
Because every year offers a greater amount of challenges than the year before. So, you know, whether it's a new board or an old board, you're still faced with some of the same problems, but some other challenges that really give you, a lot to think about and really make some decisions tough. But the good thing about it is, everybody on the board works for the benefit of the kids, and that's where, you know, the real emphasis is, and that's where the real heart of the board is.
Ray Alfred, returning board member for District 14, is looking forward to serving the needs of the students of the St. Tammany Parish public school system.
I'm very happy to be back. I'm happy to serve because it's always been a pleasure to serve the kids here on the North Shore. One good thing, we only have two new board members, so the board, we all have been working together for quite a few years now, and the two new board members that's coming on, I look at it as a pleasure of working with those guys, and we'll make sure everything works for the kids in North of St. Tammany Parish.
The school system recently held a school safety meeting for all of the principals in the district. It was time for administrators, school officials, and law enforcement to discuss ways to ensure a safe learning environment for our students.
But I can tell you, I really don't believe there's any more important principals meeting than the meeting that we're going to get ready to start on today.
You want to write down any issues at the school that you may be dealing with?
They are now, and they're getting more comfortable all the time.
And there are all kinds of issues now. That sounds wonderful.
I absolutely believe that it has to be our top priority to keep kids safe at school and employees to have a sense of well-being about their safety, too.
It is just so important to try to be proactive in these things instead of reacting. And I think that's what you're going to see and hear from us today and for the different programs and plans that we have in place. And I can just tell you that it's an opportunity for us to do something that can really help for a lot of years to come.
This is an opportunity for us to really make some progress on school safety and to begin some conversations that may lead to some even further progress on school safety and campus order.
A sense of community, including those that use your facility.
Again, the students are the ones at the first line. They know what's going on. If we can open up that line of communication with them, some feedback from them, what they see and what's happening, so that we're aware of the situation.
One of the ideas that I liked on the video was adjusting the bell schedule so we don't have all of our students in the hallway at one time.
So Crisis Awareness Week at school, maybe first semester and second semester, where you get your children, the faculty, the parents involved, having those drills, talking about it, and let the children get involved in the Awareness Week, and that's been real beneficial.
One of the things that Gail said was this school system is not a system that stands still. And I think this security summit and this safety summit that we've had with law enforcement and what we're doing with that today is very important, and it just shows that, you know, that's what we believe as a school system.
What is it that our community thinks is important about school safety and security?
Communication between law enforcement officials and our school system is a vital piece to making our schools safe environments for learning.
And by having all these people collectively together, it gives us a target. We can target in on a problem and we can move collectively toward it.
The biggest thing that makes it successful for Crime Stoppers is communication. Communication and promotion.
You know, one of the things that makes our parish so great, there are so many things, but one of them that makes our parish so great and our system so runs so well is the cooperation and the relationship that we have with our local law enforcement agencies.
We started something a while back with Slido PD over 10 years ago to where they're communicating at least once a month with our principals, and it's a great sharing of information period for us. Well, now we're moving to do this parish-wide.
If we see something going on the street, then obviously sooner or later you are going to see it in your school. And if there's something going on in your school, we're going to deal with it sooner or later on the street. So it just makes good common sense on why don't we just get together and talk about these things and work together as a unit.
In order for us to improve this whole process and keeping kids safe and our staff safe, we need to work collectively with law enforcement. And it's I'm thrilled that they are part of this process.
And I like the way that we all met with our law enforcement officers. I like the idea of meeting on a monthly basis with them.
Good law enforcement and great education work hand in hand.
I'm so pleased to announce that following the break, the start of the second semester, we were able to complete our goal of having school resource officers in every high school in St. Tammany.
It's a great need. I think a lot of the students feel safe, and the faculty feel safe just for the physical presence. I think from a law enforcement perspective, it's going to help us to in a form of prevention and help us with crime fighting.
One of the things that Trey brought back from the National Summit is that school resource officers is an effective tool for schools to use to help promote school safety and security.
The idea is to just make it a comfortable environment for everyone so that we can get the best out of everybody.
Next on our agenda, we have Ms. Darlene Cassanza. Ms. Cassanza is the executive director of the Crime Stoppers, and she's going to talk to you a little bit about our Crime Stoppers school tip hotline.
We are very pleased to announce that our hotline, our Safe School hotline, will be available to the middle and high school students in St. Tammany. And this is something that's been proven to be very successful over the United States.
Was the hotline, the communications, opening up some lines for kids to tell people what they know is going on.
Any resource that we can use, anything that might deter an incident of any kind is important. I think it's we're in good shape using them. I think it'll be a good idea.
Law enforcement overwhelmingly thought that one of the things that we could do was district-wide uniforms. In all of our schools, uniforms, it's a quick, easy access to see who belongs and who doesn't belong on a campus, and they thought that that was really important.
And remember, too, that this came up in every single focus group we had as something that should be considered.
Gears real quick and talk about the caller system. At the next principal's meeting, I'm going to train you on how to use the
caller system, and we're going to work with each one of you to send home an individual message from each school to the parents of the students in your school.
For instance, if we were going to do a school closing, we could do caller alert to call all these homes. But let's say that somebody is out of town or not at home and they've heard a rumor that schools are closing, they could then call that number.
Being able to share ideas with my colleagues and other principals and hearing different people's perspective on the issues that they have at their school, as well as the things that they do to try to make their school safer, has been very beneficial to be able to hear the things that they do.
These workshops and in-services helps us, give us information, but anything that can be done on any level, student all the way up to administrators in the school system, would make the school system better and safer. And of course, the whole idea is to make sure the parents feel like their kids are safe and they know that we're doing what we can to make things better at schools.
And that common goal is the safety of our kids so they can get a good education, which they do.
We're always trying to do it better. And the biggest thing for me is to provide a safe, positive learning environment for our students. That's what it's all about.
One of the best ways for students to learn is through hands-on learning, where students learn by doing, giving them the opportunity to become active participants instead of passive learners. As you'll see in the following segments, the students are taking part in real-life learning experiences that take them way beyond the textbook, and in some cases, even the classroom. We begin at Clearwood Junior High School, where the students in Mrs. Boudreaux's street law class are learning basic facts about street law through taking part in the real-life experience of a mock trial.
Street law is an honors elective class that I started 25 years ago, and it's where 8th grade students are, who are honors in social studies, are able to take this class to learn the basic facts about law.
And we did a lot of role playing, and we got to take it a little bit beyond just like the amendments and what's in the book. We got to really go further in and investigate what's said.
They get to do role playing of many different Supreme Court cases, as well as their culminating activity, which is their mock trial.
You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, nothing but the truth, under the penalty of perjury, law, so help you God. Set your name and occupation, and you may be seated.
This semester, they chose a case that 13 years ago, we actually saw as a street law class, and they wanted to do it.
Your Honor, may you mark this as Exhibit A.
I'll serve as a witness for the prosecution. I'll present the evidence. Well, I'll show the evidence and how it led up to the crime scene, and I'll show how everything's tied together to the defendant.
I have a judge. I have a bailiff, who is basically clerk of court. I will have 3 defense attorneys.
As the defense attorney, I will be sticking up for the supposed criminal, the defendant. I will try and prove her case as innocent and give the facts to prove her not guilty.
3 prosecuting attorneys.
And I'm going to try and prove that the person being accused of a crime is guilty.
Then we have, I believe, 12 witnesses.
As a key witness, I really think I'm going to help the case in a way that will prove the defendant not guilty.
The 7th grade, who are future students of street law, will serve as our jury.
Can you state what exactly you saw the night of June 14th?
The research for the case is there. They have 5 to 6 pages. They know what the evidence is. They know everything. My lawyers then have to go on their own and figure out what questions they want to ask of their different witnesses.
What exactly did you find on June 14th at the 500 block of Everest?
And they have the case, they do their own questions, and they decide on who's going to do opening, closing, and rebuttal. Then my witnesses, they know basically what their part is. Then they just have to make sure they know the answers with the lawyers.
You said you had seen this jacket before, correct? Around town.
I think it's wonderful because they think, and I love seeing them think.
I enjoyed the free expression the most because I'm an opinionated person, and as a lawyer in the role playing, I like to express myself a lot.
I feel that this class really helps them because they can give their opinion.
Coming from this mock trial, I think I'll definitely take away just being more open-minded. Looking at this case, just walking and looking at it, I think I'd have a lot different outlook on it than I do really looking into all the different possibilities. We've learned so many other things could have happened instead, and it's not always, a case doesn't always have to be as it appears.
In the future, I kind of have an idea of what goes on behind the scenes, so you can't always just make assumptions with like part of what's there, and like you have to actually think about it and use your common sense a bit.
The reason why I took street law is to become a lawyer when I grow up and to put criminals behind bars.
The reason why I like this class so much is because we get to take it beyond the book. We get to look at cases in depth and see what really went on and other possibilities of what could have happened.
Yeah, you really get to act out what's out there instead of just reading, going by the book. You get to live it.
I want to be an attorney because, like, people have always said I'm really good at being argumentative. And I like, it seems like something that'd be really fun to do, that show justice is served and, like, make the world a better place.
So it's perfect for them to see social studies, I guess you'd say, alive and in action.
Salmen High School broadcasting students are also participating in a real-life hands-on learning experience, meeting deadlines, writing copy, being on-air talent, and using an amazing amount of technology all come together every morning to create a real-life broadcast for the students at Salmen High School.
Open up on B and make sure you take a smoke. What's the second announcement?
It's the one about the flowers. Are we ready?
Yep.
All right, let's go.
Good morning, Salmen. This morning, please tune to TV's Channel 3 for the morning announcements.
Broadcasting's on standby.
Quiet on the set. Going live in 5, 4, 3.
Good morning, Salmen. Today is Thursday, January 25th, 2007.
Broadcasting 1 involves media production, primarily through film editing. It encompasses reading, oral and written communication skills, and the ability to manipulate computers and footage and to produce a product that we hopefully will air on Channel 13 or in our school as a relevant topic or issue. Broadcasting 2 focuses on those same topics, but it's more focused on live broadcasting.
Well, I was director.
Today I was the cameraman.
Sometimes I do transitions.
Being a news anchor is my favorite job in broadcasting.
Basically control the volume on the TV during the broadcast.
I am making sure that the people I'm training to be teleprompter operators are coming along well.
Cross-training is a very important part of our program.
Yeah, I've worked with the camera, I've worked with the teleprompter, I've worked with the transitions, the editing, and it's a good experience to get a feel of everything else, but I think that taking control is what I do best.
With cross training, you learn everybody's job, and it makes so much easier for, you know, to be like, well, here's an idea, let's throw this out, let's fix this. And everybody, you know, really calmed down once we cross trained.
Well, I have gone on as a co-anchor, and I've done directing when the director wasn't here. And it's interesting, just so we all know the parts, so in case one of us isn't here, we fill in and there's no problems.
We can all work with each other, and we get a lot of stuff done that way. It makes it a lot easier than just by yourself. You don't have all the responsibility on yourself. It's on everybody.
Originally, I thought anchoring was what I really loved to do, but I feel a little bit more freedom with editing because I can really express or portray the video how I want it to be seen in other people's eyes through editing.
Broadcasting is not just about doing morning announcement. Broadcasting involves feature stories, and it affects our community so much. I can't tell you how many times I hear from someone, oh, I saw the Katrina video, I cried. Or I saw the Black History Month, I loved it. And we're always doing feature stories, we're always doing little bitty commercials. Right now we're working on a self-respect video, and that involves yourself, your schools, you know, all aspects of respect, and I can't wait to hear the feedback from it.
The seniors are responsible for producing an end-of-the-year video, which they call the senior video.
It's very, very detailed because it includes every team, every club, event, dance, so it takes a lot of work. That's why it's our exam.
Organization is most likely the biggest thing I've learned in here, being organized and knowing that you can't just come in here the day before, or you can't come in here that morning and decide that you want to do something new. It has to be planned and it has to be organized. So that's pretty much what's helped me in all of my other classes.
Yeah, I've learned a lot here in broadcasting. I learned how to, you know, edit the videos and produce them. I've even, you know, produced a talent show video recently.
What I've learned most from being in here was working with others.
We do communicate as we learn. We do elevate the academic climate in this setting through the oral exchange and communication skills among the team itself. Through movement, yeah, hands-on, practical application.
This class is high excitement, and I try to take that into my other classes too. And technology at this school is awesome with our Elmos, our computers, our laptops. Everything is coming together very well.
The students are the ones that have to execute the task. And if we can give them the tools of the trade, as it were, to do that, then we become facilitators of the lesson. They become shareholders in that investment. And the technology just makes it so much more fun. And they respond to technology. It's all around us. So why shouldn't it be in the classroom? And it is.
Mr. Walden's teaching us that we need to work together as a group.
I think that in the long run, like, he makes sure that everything we need is here. He makes sure that anything that, you know, if anything goes wrong, he tries to make sure that it's covered or fixed.
He is an excellent teacher. He's just like, he's part of the family. He's like our dad. You know, if something's going wrong, he helps it, he fixes it, but he lets us be ourselves and run the classroom at the same time.
The privilege to teach the class allows me to be in the trenches again with the kids. And really, it's the highlight of my day. It's the first period of the day, and I love being around young people. That's why I went into teaching. It's a vocation for me. And interacting with them and, you know, hearing their creativity and their energy, it keeps us young.
It's a lot of fun for me, and I like doing stuff that's fun.
It'll help me a lot with everything I learned because I feel like I'm prepared in all aspects of the newsroom.
I think broadcasting is going to help me as a criminal justice lawyer because it helps me organize, and that's one of the main keys in being a lawyer.
It's fun because it takes everyone to make the production good, so just when it's over and it came out well, it's nice to know that everyone realized your part that you did for the thing.
Good job, everybody. Good job.
And finally, we visit some 4-H and Future Farmers of America students, where learning extends way beyond the classroom walls to the St. Tammany Parish Fairgrounds and beyond. Here, the students are participating in the 72nd Southeast District Junior Livestock Show, exhibiting animals they have raised in the hopes of gaining entry to the state livestock competition. Raising livestock animals is a real-world, hands-on experience that breeds within these students a true sense of responsibility and citizenship.
We're having the Southeast District Livestock Show. The Southeast District Livestock Show is about 75 years old. At the show, we're showing the students, FFA and 4-H members. They show their different animals that they've raised throughout the year. As you can hear in the background, we have chickens. We also have beef cattle, pigs, sheep, and goats.
I just like showing them because I think it's fun. You can like meet people when you go and show them here.
What I like working about animals is that I'm just an outdoors person and I love to be around animals and I like to have fun with them. I like to learn new things.
I like that that you can just have fun and they're just cool to handle.
Well, showing chickens is really fun because you get to meet a lot of new people and compete against them with chickens.
I just like animals because when I was young, I used to always play with animals and I always feed them. And when my dad was young, he's taught me to like animals a lot and share with me the situations he had when he was young.
You get to get outside and just run them and then exercise them. It's fun.
Well, it's really fun and you learn a whole lot about animals.
The responsibilities they learn from taking care of their animals, making sure they groom them properly, because if they show up at the show and they haven't taken care of their animal, fed, watered, and protected it, or they haven't properly groomed it, they're not going to place very high at the show.
You learn how to take care of them and like responsibility and stuff.
I enjoy the responsibility of working with animals.
The livestock program is a very big part of our school system. It's a very big part of teaching our students because they have to work at home to get ready for these shows. They have to learn how to compete and to understand that you don't always get the championship prize, but as long as you had worked as hard as you can and did your best, figure out what you could do better next time to maybe win that championship. Those qualities teach kids good skills throughout life.
I like ag because it can help me in life. I mean, it teaches me all sorts of things that I could do in life, like growing crops, building things, and taking care of animals. And one day I think I'm going to be a vet, so that helps me for later life also.
The maturity factor that they get from going to these livestock shows, being around other positive, upbeat students who are involved in our programs, and they learn a lot as they go through the years.
Thanks for watching this edition of Chalk Talk. For information about our broadcast schedule, please go to our website at www.stpsb.org. Follow the link to Channel 13. Join us now for the Sights and Sounds at Bonne, Ecole Elementary School, where Mrs. Daly's third grade art students are learning the differences between two-dimensional and three-dimensional art. Today, they are creating 2D line drawings, which will later become three-dimensional sculptures, thereby giving the students an appreciation and understanding of different visual art forms.
Here comes the sun, here comes the sun, I say, it's all right.
The children are beginning to realize the artist had certain thoughts when they did the painting, but you bring to the art a different meaning, the meaning that's inside your own head. They have their ideas in their heads, and it's difficult to sometimes express it through language, but when they're actually drawing it, they can express so much more. And so the creative side of them comes out, and that's what I try to allow. I'll give them an idea or a thought to start with, but I don't dictate what they have to do. I try to get them to use their own ideas, and I try to get them to make connections between what I'm saying and teaching them and what they know about. It just pleases me to hear the young children talk. I had kindergartners in here yesterday having a discussion or a disagreement about which artist they liked better, Matisse or Picasso. I mean, that's just so rewarding as a teacher. And not only could they say, I like this one or I like that one, they could tell you why.